Good morning, church. What a great day it is to be in the house of the Lord. Amen? Amen. And Merry Christmas. I hope you all have a wonderful Christmas. If you're a guest with us today, we just want to say welcome and thank you so much for joining us. In our bulletin, we have that connection card. If you'd fill that out for us, we'd love to follow up with you and just get to know you. We appreciate you joining us today. If any of you have any prayer requests or praises, you can let us know through your connection card and put that in the offering plate for us. We'd love to pray with you. Also, if we don't have your email address, you can write that on that connection card. We'll make sure you get added to our email list, okay? A few updates for this week. The church office will be closed this week due to Christmas. We won't be having our live stream on Wednesday or our youth and children's ministry this week. I have been told, though, by Pastor Greg that if there is an emergency, he will be on call this week and you can contact him, okay? All right. Also, we have our Christmas Eve service that is still happening this week. We have our 4:30 and 6 o'clock services. And just to encourage you, the 6 o'clock service will be live streamed. So I don't know about you, I'm going to be traveling, but I get to tune in for that live stream. So make sure to take part in that. We are still taking reservations this week, but again, the church office is closed. So if you have not made your reservation, you still want to come, I'm Pastor Greg. You can contact Pastor Greg, and he'll make sure that you get added to one of those services, okay? We do not, I was just told, have offering envelopes for Lottie Moon Christmas offering. So this morning, if you'd like to give towards Lottie Moon Christmas offering, again, 100% of that goes towards supporting our missionaries. Go ahead and label that on your offering envelope for us, okay? And we'll make sure to get envelopes back there very soon. We also have those You're Invited cards on that back table. So be sure to grab one of those. Invite someone to church with you this next week, okay? Again, just a blessing to see you here today in the Lord's house. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Father God, we do just thank you so much for this wonderful day that you've blessed us with, just for the sunshine outside, Lord. It is just a blessing to be here. Lord, I thank you for each of these, my brothers and my sisters, gathered here today in your house. I thank you for those who are tuning in on the live stream, Lord. We thank you for that. It's just a blessing for that to have that technology, Lord, that you've gifted us with. Lord, we pray for this week and every day, Lord, as we just celebrate your son, Jesus, our Savior, his death and resurrection on the cross, so that if we trust and believe in him, we can be saved. And Lord, I pray if there's even one here today, Lord, in person or listening on the live stream that don't know you as Lord and Savior, that this would be the day that they would accept your son, Lord, as their Savior. Father, we thank you for this time that we have now to come to worship you in praise and song. And through the studying of your word, Lord, I thank you for the choir here, for Brother Mark. I just pray you be with them as they lead us in worship. Father, I thank you for Pastor Greg and for the message that you've put on his heart this day. And I would just pray that you'd speak through him with your spirit, that we'd open our ears to hear what we need to hear, that we would apply your word, Father, to our hearts. Father, use us each and every day to honor, to glorify you, to further your kingdom. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We are going to have our Lottie Moon Christmas video up on the screens, so go ahead and look to the screens.
Here in Thailand, there are so many people who don't know God, and no one they know knows God.
Thai people have a desperate desire to get rid of the sin that they know they have. They're going to the temples and they're taking money and gold and flowers and anything they can do that they think is good that might erase the sin that they know that is inside them.
My calling to be a doctor and calling to be a missionary came on the same day. When a missionary came and spoke at our church, he said the line, "The saddest thing I've seen after 35 years on the mission field is children sick and dying because there's no doctor to care for them." And it was a lightning bolt through my soul. And I said, "Okay, God, I'll be a medical missionary."
Our ministry here takes mobile clinics all over the country of Thailand. Church planners call me up and say, "I'm trying to start a new church where there's never been one. Will you come and help me?" Medicine is just a means for me to share the gospel with those who have no other access. When I talk about how to take care of their physical needs, it's just so easy for them to see when I start talking about their soul that they need a savior as well. And American churches have partnered with me in that. And they have sent me short-term mission teams that come with me for about a week every month. And we go out and do mobile clinics all over the country. Without the churches coming alongside me, I cannot do what I do. In general, people here do not like talking about spiritual things. But on mobile clinic, we can talk to 100 people in a day, 200 people, 300 people in a day that will come to mobile clinic, and there we can share Christ with so many people at one time. It makes mobile clinic a great avenue for sharing the gospel. The point of mobile clinics is to start churches, groups of Thai believers that will go on to grow people in their new faith, to disciple them in their understanding of who Christ is, and to grow them together into groups that will become churches. There's a lot of things that money can't buy. Being able to be here and see God praised where He has never been praised before, that is a dear joy. Seeing souls saved in areas where no one has ever known God before, watching them grow in their faith and lead others to faith, and watching them grow together into churches, seeing churches start where no one has ever worshiped God before. Money can't buy that.
We have a great opportunity through our giving to Lottie Moon to support missionaries like we just heard from, this medical missionary. We have set a goal as a church of $15,000. We are on the way towards that, but I encourage you, if you've not had a chance yet, to pray through what you'd like to give. Bring a great gift to the Lord's house to share with people around the world that they may hear the gospel. Today's candle is a purple candle. It is the angel's candle. I read to you from Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 11. For unto you was born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom He is pleased. The fourth candle does represent peace and is called the angel's candle. The angels came announcing that Jesus came to bring peace. He came to bring people close to God and to each other once again. May we celebrate that peace this morning.
Well, it's so good to be with you. So glad that you've come to worship the Lord this morning. And we want to just encourage you to worship and sing as we sing these Christmas carols. Let's stand together. Angels we have heard on high. Mm-hmm. Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strain. Gloria in excelsis Deo, say what may the tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song. Gloria in excelsis Deo. See Him in a manger laid,
while our hearts in love we raise Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Sing together, Away in a Manger.
Away in a manger, no crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky look down where he lay, the little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care, and fit us for heaven to live with thee there.
Amen. You may be seated.
Precious promise, Son of God and Son of Man. Heaven's glory in a manger has come to us in Bethlehem. Holy night, Messiah, Messiah, the baby born. precious promise coming back again.
Thank you, choir. That was very beautiful, very beautiful. Open your Bibles with me to Exodus chapter 9. We're looking today at verses 1 through 7. Exodus chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. If you are able to stand, please join me as we read God's word together. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go into Pharaoh and say to him, 'Thus says the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For if you refuse to let them go and still hold them, behold, the hand of the Lord will fall with a very severe plague upon your livestock that are in the field, the horses, the donkeys, the camels, the herds, and the flocks. But the Lord will make a distinction between the livestock of Israel and the livestock of Egypt, so that nothing of all that belongs to the people of Israel shall die.' And the Lord set a time, saying, 'Tomorrow the Lord will do this thing in the land.' And the next day the Lord did this thing. All the livestock of the Egyptians died, but not one of the livestock of the people of Israel died. And Pharaoh sent, and behold, not one of the livestock of Israel was dead, but the heart of Pharaoh was hardened, and he did not let the people go." Let's pray together. Lord, we are grateful for your word. We're very thankful for the opportunity to gather, to join through the live stream, to be a part of a worship service together. Lord, may your spirit continue to move in our presence. May you touch each of our hearts. May we apply the truth of these words from Scripture to our lives. Shape us, Lord. If there is one who has not given his or her heart to you, may this be the day, may this be the hour when you reach and touch them and they cannot say no again today. Let them, we pray, respond to you. Let each of us respond to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. A man by the name of Floyd Snyder wrote a book entitled Evangelism for the Faint-Hearted. And he tells in this book, one of his stories was about a Christian student who was rooming with a Muslim student. And through the course of the year, early on, they began to get acquainted with one another, and soon their conversations turned to spiritual matters. The Christian asked the Muslim, "Have you ever read the Bible?" And the Muslim said, "No, I've never read the Bible. Have you ever read the Quran?" And the Christian student said, "No, I've never read the Quran." But they decided to read both of these books together. They would take turns alternating and looking at what the books had to say to them. Well, during the second term, as their friendship grew, the Muslim came to know Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. One evening, late in the term. He burst into the room and shouted at the long-term believer, "You deceived me." And the Christian student said, "What are you talking about?" And the new believer opened up his Bible. He said, "I've been reading it through like you told me, and I just read that the Word of God is living and active." And then he grinned, and he said to the Christian, the long-term time Christian, "You knew all along that the Bible contained God's power and that the Quran is a book like any other. I never had a chance." And the believer said this, "And now you will hate me for life." And this former Muslim said, "No, but it was an unfair contest." You know, here we are only as far as the fifth plague, and we're looking and we're seeing things that Pharaoh does not seem to be seeing himself. Pharaoh is waging a war against God, but it, believe me, is an unfair fight. We know that victory will come at the Lord's hand. I want us to today do things just a tiny bit differently. Note a few things of importance in the passage and then finish applying several truths. The first thing I want us to note is in verse 3, we read there, "Behold, the hand of the Lord will fall with a very severe plague upon your livestock that are in the field, the horses, the donkeys, the camels, the herds, and the flock." Now in verse 3, Moses announces that this plague will be brought on by the hand of God. None of the prior plagues had been announced in this particular fashion. He had, of course, caused all others, but now Moses is warning Pharaoh that God is going to make this happen in a big way. It seems to me, and perhaps to you as well, that as we go through these plagues, they are steadily increasing in intensity. Moses states that the hand of the Lord will bring a, depending on your translation, a terrible plague. Where we read from the ESV is a very literal translation. It speaks of severe plague. I know NIV reads a terrible plague. Remember that during the plague of gnats, you need to go back just a little bit, that the magicians had said to Pharaoh that this plague has been brought on by the finger of God. Chapter 8, verse 19. Plague brought on by the finger of God. And I hope you remember our discussion. They were referring to a supernatural power and not to Yahweh himself. But now Moses points out that the events that they have deemed to be supernatural are so much more than that. They're taking place because the God of the Hebrews is putting his hand to work. I want to go to verse 6. Verse 6 in the ESV translates the original as, "All the livestock of the Egyptians died." Now here is a point, and I go over this, I know you're with me on this, but I want you to understand, there are many people who say there are contradictions in the Bible. And this is a place where they would look and say, well, here's a contradiction. In verse 6, we read, "All the livestock of the Egyptians died." Yet, when we read in the account of the seventh plague, just later in the chapter, verse 19, it is clear that livestock are still alive. At the time of the final plague, the death of the firstborn, we see in chapter 11, there are still livestock alive. So how do we account for that? How can we say that all the livestock was put to death or died, and yet we read just a chapter, or in the same chapter, and then two chapters over, that there were still livestock? Well, what's the explanation? The ESV translates the Hebrew word kol, K-O-L, as it is usually translated. Usually when that word is seen, it is translated as all, this A-L-L. But it may also mean all sorts of. It may mean from all over. It may mean all over the place. So perhaps a better rendering or translation would have been this: all sorts of Egyptian livestock died, or Egyptian livestock died all over the place. And so you can see with looking at the translation, it is really not a contradiction between two places in Scripture. Let's go to verse 7. In verse 7, we see that Pharaoh is sending out men to investigate the land to see what has happened after this plague has fallen on Egypt. Why did he investigate? I think first to see if the disaster had just been a natural occurrence. He wanted to see and look at the land of the Israelites. Did this happen on the Israelites just like it has happened on the Egyptian land? But it was also to see if God had turned his back on his own people. You know, as we've gotten to this point, the effects of the other plagues would have been easier to hide had the Israelites been so inclined. They wouldn't have been able to hide dead livestock so easily, though. They would have been out in their fields and they couldn't have hid them. Pharaoh found out that God had spared Israel and he had not spared Egypt. Pharaoh had a hardness of heart. It really seems to be underscored here. I want you to think with me about the importance of cattle. They were necessary for life. Their lives were viewed as being sacred in Egyptian theology. And a word from Pharaoh would have spared all the livestock in the land. But his heart was as hard as steel. And he would not speak the word that would bring help to his people, help to the land. Well, I want us to begin applying this passage, going back to verse 2. We read, therefore, if you refuse to let them go and still hold them. Now, verse 2, Moses uses wording that has not yet been used in any of the other confrontations. He says, if you refuse to let them go and still hold them. He is adding that to his earlier encounters in the conversations that they had had. This is a great reminder. Here's the application of this point. God's people belong in a specific place. What is that specific place? Well, at a time, it can be very specific to a people as it is here. Israel was being called to go out and worship. At other times, it can be very individual. Delight yourself in the Lord, Scripture says, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Well, our hearts desire different things. Even in ministry, there are things that we are called to, but that is the place that we are to be. We are not to be held back by others. We are not to shy back from the work and disposition that God calls us to. In the New Testament, in 1 Peter 2:9, we read these words, but you are a chosen people. A chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation belonging to God. Now hear this. This is what's most important here, I believe. That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. Just think about that. You are royal priesthood. You are called and chosen people to do what? To declare the praise of God in a dark world. And that's what we're called to do. In our work, our dealings, I put in my notes, our dealings are to be honorable. But you can probably think of a better word. Certainly we're to be honorable, but we're to be more than that. We're to be upright. We're to be above reproach in all that we do so that people look on and say, there's something different about this guy, about this gal. There's something different. What is it? They serve the Lord and they will not act in any other way but honesty. And that needs to be seen. In our dating and marrying, we are to submit to biblical guidance. God's word has not changed that premarital sex is not his plan for us, for his people. And yet people say, well, things are different this day. We're not living in an old-fashioned way. And they will choose to really defile the marriage bed before they're even married in a try it before you buy it type attitude. God's word has not changed. Our relationships with our husbands and wives are to be protected. They are be to maintain and pure. Our relationships and parenting, we need again to do the right things with our children, to help them, as the Bible would say, to point them in the direction. The Bible uses the word bent. And we're, as an arrow, we're to fire them toward their bent, how they've been created by God, what they've been created to do, how they've been gifted. We are to encourage those things as they walk and serve the Lord. Don't fall, don't fail in those steps. Garrison Keillor writes, this book is entitled, We Are Still Married. I'm going to hit on parents for a minute. He says, the town ball club was the Lake Wobegon Schroeders, so named because the 9 starting players were all brothers. They were the sons of E.J. Schroeder. E.J. would get upset if one of his boys hit a bad pitch. He'd spit, he'd curse, he'd holler at him. And if a son hit a home run, EJ would say, blind man could have hit that one. Your grandma could have put wood on that one. If a guy couldn't have hit that one out, there'd be something wrong with him, I'd say. Wind practically took that one out of here, didn't even need to hit it much. And then he'd lean over and spit, never giving his sons encouragement. So his sons could never please him. And if they did, he would forget it very clearly. Once against a team from Freeport, his oldest son, Edwin Jim Jr., turned and ran in center field for a long, long fly ball. He threw his glove up. Now, this may be a little bit of a story. He threw his glove 40 feet in the air to snag the ball and caught the glove with the ball in it when it came down. And when he turned to the dugout to see how his dad responded to the catch, EJ was on his feet clapping. But when he saw that his son was watching, when he looked at him, he immediately pretended to be swatting mosquitoes. The batter was called out. It was the third out. Jim ran back to the bench, and he stood by his dad. EJ sat chewing in silence and finally said, I saw a man in Superior, Wisconsin do that a long time ago, but he did it at night, and the ball was hit a lot harder. We better be sure we're not holding God's children back. And I can tell you in our passage, like the man in the story, Pharaoh was holding back the children of God. Don't get in the way of the Lord. Encourage your children. Encourage the children of God, our brothers, our sisters, to serve God faithfully. Well, let's look at verse 5 now. Verse 5, and the Lord set a time, saying, tomorrow the Lord will do this thing in the land. When the plague of frogs came upon the land, the Lord allowed Pharaoh to set a time for relief. It was a gracious act by the Lord. He said to Pharaoh through Moses, set the time for this plague to end. That was in chapter 8, verse 9. Pharaoh did not learn from that display of kindness. He did not learn from the graciousness that had been shown him. This time, the Lord didn't give Pharaoh another chance. He set the time. And the application for us is this: when will our chances end? When will our chances end? Scripture is very clear. Proverbs 27:1, do not boast about tomorrow, for no man knows what a day may bring forth. We don't know that we will have tomorrow. We don't know that we will have the rest of the day. And even in Hebrews 3:7-8, today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts. When God is calling you to something, that is the moment to respond, not to put it off, but to act in obedience. I want you to think, why are we looking at Exodus during Christmas? Well, in my years, when I'm studying books, I usually stay through and I might have a holiday sermon to recognize that particular holiday. But a lot of times I try to look at where we are in Scripture and hear also what it has to say to us this day. Think about this truth. The Lord set a time. The Lord set a time. And I want you to think back over 2,000 years, because the Lord had looked at a world, as the Old Testament describes it, a world that was walking in darkness. And there needed to be something to break that darkness. A world who was living in sin. And God selected a time. You know, what we celebrate as Christmas, that time was the birth of his son Jesus. God selected a time for him to be born. God selected a time for him to live his life, to live sinlessly, to lead others to follow God, to give his life ultimately on the cross. The cross is important at Christmas because the cradle has no importance until we see what ultimately happens at the cross. Jesus giving his life because God set a time. Jesus died for every one of us. He offers to us salvation. And even that, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. In verse 6, I'm moving on now, verse 6, and the next day, the Lord did this thing. We see here described the actuation of what had been warned and what had been predicted. This verse is a reminder. Our application is this: God does what he says he will do, and He is who he says he is. Now, again, I think this is particularly encouraging here at Christmas. It's particularly encouraging in what we are dealing with as in the world and in society. This is a particularly encouraging thing to think about when we remember all the promises of encouragement to come through the Bible. Surely I cannot tackle them right now, but I'm going to give you a lot. And I just want you to be encouraged as you hear this. Deuteronomy 4:31, he will not abandon. Psalm 139:21, he abhors those who rise up against us. Daniel 3:17, he is able to save us. 2 Corinthians 9:8, he is able to make all grace abound to you. Psalm 68:9, he gives abundant showers. Psalm 6:9, he accepts our prayers. Matthew 10:32, he will acknowledge us before God. Hebrews 4:12, his word is living and active. Ephesians 1:5, he predestined to adopt us as his sons. Job 16:19, he is our advocate. Psalm 9:12, he hears the cry of the afflicted. 1 Samuel 2:6, he makes alive. Genesis 17:1, he is almighty. Revelation 1:8, he is Alpha and Omega. Deuteronomy 32:35, he will avenge. Job 37:22, he is awesome. Exodus 17:15, he is our banner. 2 Chronicles 32:8, he goes before us in battle. Psalm 68:19, he bears our burdens. Ecclesiastes 3:11, he makes all things beautiful. John 1:1, he was in the beginning. Psalm 84:11, he bestows favor and honor. Proverbs 2:7, he is a shield to the blameless. 1 Peter 1:19, he is without blemish. Psalm 29:11, he blesses his people with peace. John 9:25, he gives sight to the blind. Romans 5:9, he justifies us through his blood. Psalm 51:1, he blots out our transgressions. Ezra 9:9, he does not desert us in our bondage. Isaiah 53:12, he bore the sins of many. 1 John 3:9, he was born of God. Matthew 6:11, he gives daily bread. Psalm 34:18, he is close to the brokenhearted. Hebrews 3:4, he is the builder of all things. 1 Kings 18:27, he is not too busy. And at Christmas, we celebrate God with us. He is Emmanuel. God is with us. Amen. And we celebrate that. And that's something that we can just be lifted up and encouraged by. Our last verse, verse 7, we're told that Pharaoh's heart was unyielding. His resistance was moving him toward a complete and a tragic defeat. And our application is this, is our hardened heart doing the same? Is the hardness of our heart keeping us from what God wants for us? Max Lucado recounts a story. The man's name was Steve Verhoff. And Steve Verhoff had an experience in a church on the coast of Sweden. It was of a different faith. You'll know by what I tell you in this story. There were a handful of people there. They were faithful. They gathered to sing, to pray together, to celebrate communion. And Stephen took his turn at the altar. He received the bread and the wine, and he returned into his seat. As the minister turned his back on the congregation, he began to put away the elements. And the rest of the congregation, as small as it was, they noticed two more worshipers coming forward. One was a middle-aged woman. She was pushing her mother in a wheelchair. And the mother, and this is what Verhoff wrote, had the classic nursing home look. She was slumped to the right. She was thin. She was scraggly. Her hair was colorless. She had vacant eyes and a slack jaw with her tongue showing a bit. She was here for communion. Everyone but the minister knew that the two women were waiting there at the altar. When he finally realized their presence, he retrieved the elements and administered the piece of bread and the sip of wine. He then paused, looked the old woman directly in the eye, and declared the customary blessing. Our Lord Jesus Christ, whose body and blood you have received, preserve your soul unto everlasting life. And Verhoff writes, it struck me, the irony. The woman was too old to keep her balance. She couldn't keep her head straight. She brought nothing but a bent body and feeble bones. And he made a very cold statement to himself. He said, can anyone believe that heaven cares for such a soul? And he said, the moment that I asked that question within me, the church bells erupted, they pealed, they were ringing unexpectedly and majestically. It was as if God himself was declaring, I will claim the frail, I will preserve the weak and secure the weary. Let them come. Let them come. And the truth is, none of us come to God with anything more than this feeble old lady. But she came. Will you? Let's stand and pray together. Lord, we are grateful for your word, for the opportunity today to spend time in study and worship. Lord, we come to you just as this old lady came, with nothing to offer. We come to receive your grace, your mercy poured out upon us. And for some of us, we need first to receive the gift of salvation. If you've never asked Jesus into your heart, won't you do that today? Won't you ask for forgiveness of sin? Won't you ask for eternity in heaven? Won't you ask for Jesus to come and live inside of you? Lord, I pray during this time of invitation and commitment that if you've led anyone to decision, you would touch their hearts and just give them courage to respond. I pray for those standing here that they would step out from where they're standing. I pray for those who are watching on the live stream that they would make a commitment to reach out to someone in this church or someone that they know is a believer and share their decision this day. Lord, may your spirit move in our midst. May we come to you. You are faithful. May we be faithful in our response this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As Brother Mark leads us in our hymn of invitation and commitment, if you have a decision to make, you come as we sing.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. We'll praise his name forever. We'll praise his name forever, we'll praise his name forever, Christ the Lord. We'll give him all the glory, we'll give him all the glory, we'll give him all the glory. Christ the Lord.
Well, thank you all for being here today. I thank those watching on live stream for joining us. Wish you all a Merry Christmas. I know some of you will be traveling away. Be safe in your travels. I look forward to seeing those of you who stay in town. Christmas Eve night, one of our services, and I know Brother Sam mentioned it. If you would like a spot, please give me a call during the week and we will make sure there is a spot reserved for you and your family. God bless you each. You are dismissed.